feeling of the Grand Canyon. It's easy to imagine a trip down a quieter version of the Colorado River. Well, the man in our next story tonight is a man many associate with Colorado and the Rocky Mountains. His name is John Denver, a singer who sold more than 100 million records. PM Magazine's Henry Tannenbaum meets with this versatile performer to talk about his career and about an important cause in his life. Sunshine swept
out in the rain. His real name is Henry John Deutschendorf, but come on, you know he's John Denver. For years he's been singing about love and beauty and the great outdoors. Today, after millions of record sales, a starring role in a film, and highly acclaimed TV specials, he's become one of the most popular entertainers in the world.
I'm curious about the greening of John Denver. How did you go from Henry Deutschendorf to John Denver? What was the process?
Well, I've thought a lot about that, as a matter of fact. It's kind of interesting to me, things that I feel, that I feel them as strongly as I do. I think that part of it has to do with my Air Force upbringing. You know, my father was transferred from here to here, from here to here, and so I lived in a lot of different places. And I was put in what I consider to be a lot of difficult situations when I was a child. I found two things. One, I found that my music worked for me everywhere I went. It made friends for me. It opened doors for me. The other thing that I found is that people, regardless of where I went when I was a kid, and I was told, you know, when I left Tucson, Arizona, and we went to school, I went to school with Mexican children and black children, and everybody went to the same school. No big deal, you know. But we...
Hi!
We moved from there to Montgomery, Alabama, where schools were segregated, you know? Weren't very many Mexicans there. It's not close to the border. And there were a lot of black people, but boy, they lived someplace else and they went to school someplace else. That was interesting to me, especially in regard to the fact that I didn't see that people were any different there, you know? Then I worked on wheat harvest, farmers up and down the middle of the United States, from Texas up to North Dakota. And I found all of those people to be just like everybody else that I'd met. Then I worked in a lumber camp. I found those people to be, you know, people, human beings. And I found that I could get along with all of them and had something to relate to with all of them. And as I've started traveling around the world and go someplace, you know, with the opportunities that this music has given me, and I find people in Japan who have no idea what the Rocky Mountains are, and they'll sing Rocky Mountain High with me word for word, and two-thirds of an audience of 20,000 people doesn't understand English. That's great. That's far out.
You haven't had a hit record in 3 years, and yet people still listen to you. You're still very popular. Why do you think John Denver is still successful?
See, I think I don't threaten anybody. I think that's one of the reasons for my success. I think that the guys who bring the gals to concerts and stuff, they're not threatened by me. What happens is that their affection for this lady is enhanced by what I do on stage and the songs that I sing about my wife, Annie, and about my family.
That's wonderful.
It's wonderful.
No offense or anything, but it's so strange to talk to someone that has so many positive things to say and so many up things to say about the goodness of people. I mean, surely you have your dark moments. Does John Denver ever get depressed?
Well, yeah, I do. I get depressed when I'm not feeling some of these things so very strongly. I get depressed when I don't live up to the human being that I would like to be, or to some of the people who are an inspiration to me. And I'm, you know, I'm a real. Sometimes you ask Annie, I'm sloppy. I'm lazy a lot of the times. Sometimes I get off in a corner by myself and I really want to be alone, and I'm difficult to communicate with. And I think Annie feels that, my friends feel that. And when they do, I'm a pretty hard person to live with. I'm just like everybody else. I mean, I use four-letter words and Sometimes I feel like I drink too much. I really enjoy wine with dinner. I'm not a boozer, you know, I don't get drunk. But I drink more than I feel reflects how I want to live. Healthy, like that aspect of it. I eat chocolate too much, you know.
But he has other concerns of a much deeper, more global nature. He has devoted himself to the fight against world hunger. He is a member of the President's Commission on World Hunger, and his song, I Want to Live, is a protest against the world's mass starvation. No more
killing. There are so many causes today. Now, why have you selected hunger as one special cause?
We've come to a time here on this planet where it's under the rug or in the closet, or say it's happening over there and doesn't really concern me, you know? The world has gotten so small that we really have to start looking at it as a whole, not pieces, but a whole. And if there are children starving someplace else in the world, physically someplace else, they're still my children. You know, they're part of my family, the family of man, of human beings.
Along with his song, he produced this documentary, also called I Want to Live, which sums up his despair and his hope.
I'll be working on this the rest of my life.